Our purpose was to collect the fate of the patients with CML who are not included particularly or specifically in clinical studies. This is extremely important because you know that when we are talking about studies, generally we are a little bit performing a bias and a selection of the patients, whereas in this case we have a registry which is really reporting what is happening in real life. And we took advantage of the fact that in Italy we have now centers which are quite specialized in treating CML. They have generally associated with a very good molecular and cytogenetic lab just to perform an evaluation of the response. And so with many of these centers which are affiliated with the GMEMA study group, indeed, we collected the data of so far we have enrolled more than 2,000 patients, but now we reported data that we have in 1,200 patients where the dose with at least 2 years of follow-up. And indeed, just exploring the characteristics of these patients and just by subdividing them according to the different risk groups, we have established a number of very interesting, apparently simple, but very useful in clinical practice observation. First of all, we noticed that 10% of these patients, in addition to the presence of the Philadelphia chromosome, they have also other cytogenetic abnormalities. And two-thirds of these abnormalities were the major root abnormalities, which is telling us that indeed these cases should be followed with particular attention because we know that they are associated with a worse prognosis. Of course, this implies that we say evaluation, a cytogenetic evaluation of the bone marrow diagnosis, as suggested in the recommendation of the guidelines, is absolutely necessary because we have to pick up these patients among the others. The second point is that if we are using the classical definition of the so-called risk, as well as the risk for called Euro UTOS and UTOS for long-term survivals, we have seen that there is a quite high difference, in particular in the percentage of the patients which are falling in the risk group, intermediate and high. Therefore, if we are comparing, for example, the most used of this scoring system, which is the so-called, together with the ELTS, UTOS long-term survival score system, what we observed that with the last one, we have a restricted number of the intermediate and high-risk patients, and is really in this case we are predicting better the outcome of the patients in terms of, in particular, in terms of overall survival with respect to what we can see with SoCals. This is probably due to the fact that in SoCals we have a quite high weight represented by the age, whereas in the UTOS long-term system this is not happening. And this, of course, is what it contributes. It's exploring in depth, I would say, more the biology of the disease rather than the age of the patients. And this is an important point. Then the other aspect that we have seen is that is related to the therapy and the influence of the therapy on the overall survival. And what we have seen is that as half of our patients treated between 2014 and 2016, at least, were treated with second-generation TKIs, half with imatinib, most of them with the brand imatinib. Indeed, we observed that second-generation TKIs are particularly good not for the low-risk patients, and this was quite obvious, but for the intermediate ELTS patients. In which indeed they are having a difference in terms of overall survival, which is statistically significant. We observed also an advantage in terms for the high risk group, but not able to achieve a statistical significance, at least for the moment. And this is an important aspect that we have to consider, just making a choice as a first line therapy for CML patients.